أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله الحمد لله after a long break we are restarting the tafsir with the Surah Al-Kahf inshallah chapter 18 the surah is one of the most famous surahs because of the story of Ashab al-Kahf in the Quran. And in fact, it contains three major stories. One is the story of Ashab al-Kahf. The other is the story of Musa and the knowledgeable man, which is thought to be Khidr alayhi salam. But of course, there are other possibilities as well. And the other one is the story of Dhul Qarnayn, the man who traveled from east to west. And there is another story mentioned in the surah, which is not quite clear in terms of the setting, in terms of the context, where it happened, about whom it talks. It talks about two men having a conversation about their position in this world. All these stories are actually mentioned in the surah to expound and elaborate on what has come in the beginning of the surah. In verses 7 and 8, or 6 and 7, it says, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا سَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. We have made whatever is on the earth as an adornment for it, and we will make it a barren plain soon. And we have made that all adornment and then making it a barren plain to test them who is best in their action. And then all these surahs are actually told, and the stories are brought in to explain how actually this operates, this system of making adornments on the earth and then again making it a barren plain later on, how in the phase of the life of every individual this happens. And if we have open eyes, we can see that. So the stories are actually mentioned for that purpose. Now, the surah is revealed in Mecca. So it's Makkiyah and it has 110 verses. About Sabab al-Nuzul of the surah, there's a hadith reported by Al-Qummi in his tafsir. And the hadith says that three of the most prominent intellectual personalities of Mecca were chosen to somehow defeat the Prophet, peace be on him, by intellectual arguments, because they actually tried every possible avenue to defeat the Prophet in his argument. They couldn't. So three of the most famous intellectuals in Mecca was Nadhr ibn Harith, about whom we hear a lot in the Quran, in Surah Luqman, in Surah Jathia, the way he argued against the Prophet. And then the other one was Uqbat ibn Abi Mu'ayt, about whom again we hear in other places in the Quran. And also As ibn Wa'il al-Sahmi. These three went as a delegation to find out how can they defeat the Prophet by good arguments. So they went to Najran to visit the Jews and Christians there. As the hadith says, Jews and Christians. But who they had in mind, we don't know, because Medina had Jews as well and had Christians as well and was much closer. Apparently, they had some contacts there in Najran, in Yemen. And they had in mind to go and ask them. Probably they were famous. The hadith doesn't mention who these people were. to whom these three went to ask questions. But we can understand, of course, they had some contacts there. They were famous, prominent Jewish scholars, and they wanted to find out how can they bring something, some knowledge, some questions to the Prophet who could that could defeat him in argument. So they went there, and they asked those people, their contacts, how can we defeat this man who claims to be a prophet? Do you have any knowledge in your books? And this is very interesting, because these three believed that the books of Jews and Christians contain some knowledge, some spiritual knowledge, by which they could defeat the prophet, peace be on him. So they went there, and they asked them, okay, can you tell us something about the knowledge which you find in your books, by which we can go and defeat this man? Apparently, these three stories which are mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf were among the most secret type of stories and knowledge in their books, which they thought that no one would know about it. Of course, the Jews in Medina had some contact with the Prophet before, and apparently they had raised these stories knowing that the Jews in Medina also would not know the answer for this. Otherwise, they wouldn't have mentioned these three stories. So they said to these three people of the delegation that you go and ask him about the story of several young men who disappeared and went into sleep, and after a long time, they woke up and asked them what was their number, how long, probably, they stayed in their cave, in their place. Of course, they didn't mention anything of the cave. And what did they take with them, and what happened to them afterwards? So this was one question. The other question was, ask him about a man who met Musa and taught him some knowledge, and ask him about a traveler who traveled to the east and the east and the west until he came to the dam of Ya'juj and Ma'juj, these three stories. And then they gave them the answers. These are the answers for it. If he gives you what we report for you from our books, then he's right. He's actually honest. If he tells you different things and other things, then you should know that he's a liar. And then ask him about one other thing. If he tells you that he knows the answer, he's a liar. If he tells you that he doesn't know the answer, he's honest. He's telling the truth. And that is when the Qiyamah would take place, when the resurrection would take place. Because we know from our books that no one ever would know the answer to this question. No one in the world, including angels and human beings, no one knows. So they were equipped with these questions, and they came back and went to Abu Talib and said that we want to test your nephew, if he's truthful or not, and we have come with some questions. We have come with some knowledge from Najran. And Abu Talib, of course, arranged, they met the Prophet, and the Prophet told them, after they posed these questions to the Prophet, he told them, I will let you know tomorrow. I will tell you tomorrow about the answers, because I don't know myself. I have to receive revelation in this regard. And then, you know this story. The revelation was stopped for 40 days. And we can imagine what happened, of course. They asked these questions, and the Prophet said, I will inform you tomorrow. Tomorrow passed, the day after tomorrow, next week. Prophet didn't find any answer. And they spread, of course, the rumors in Mecca that we have defeated Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he doesn't know the answer to these things. And he told us that I will inform you. He is not informing us. And after 40 days, the revelation came. And the whole Surah Kahf, all as a whole, as one chapter, was revealed to the Prophet, peace be on him. And the hadith says, in Tafsir al-Qumbi, the hadith says that Prophet said to Jibreel, لَقَدْ أَبْطَعْتَ, you were slow bringing revelation to me. Why? Of course, you know what happened during these 40 days, what happened in Mecca, what a sort of commotion and happiness on the other side and sadness on the side of my companions. And he said, of course, وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرَ رَبِّكَ, we cannot come down by our own accord. We only come from the order, by the order of Allah. And then we have those verses after the story of Ashab al-Kahf, that's وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ, never say I do something tomorrow unless Allah wills it. Of course, we'll discuss this when we come to this verse. The Prophet assumed that revelation would come, because as a matter of course, because whenever he wanted to know something, whenever a question was posed to him, he actually said, okay, I will inform you tomorrow or later, and revelation came. And this assumption led the Prophet to think that, okay, I will inform them tomorrow. And it was a sort of reminder by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that don't take things for granted. Of course, for us, we take things for granted which are very common in our daily life. For prophets, he took it for granted that revelation will come. And it was a reminder that never take anything for granted. You have to wait for things to be willed by Allah. What lesson it teaches us, and what lesson it teaches the people of Mecca, and what reminder it brings to the Prophet, inshallah, we'll discuss it when we come to the verse itself. Okay. The surah starts with the verse, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab, walam yaj'al lahu awaja. Now, before going to that, there are certain, many traditions about the merits of reciting this surah. One tradition which is reported by Al-Waqidi from the Prophet, peace be on him, is saying that من حفظ عشر آيات من أول سورة الكهف ثم أدرك الدجال لم يضره ومن حفظ خواتيم سورة الكهف كانت له نورا يوم القيامة. Whoever memorizes or captures this hifz here probably means bring it into the heart, not the letters, the meanings. Bring these meanings to the heart. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense just by memorizing the first 10 verses of the surah, something happened. Whoever hafiza probably captured the meaning of these 10 verses from the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf, and then he or she meets Dajjal, the time of Dajjal, it is not going to harm them. And it is quite clear that if anyone really gets the meaning of these 10 verses and internalizes the meaning of the 10 verses at the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf, certainly nothing spiritually would harm them, whether it's Dajjal or anything else. And whoever hafiza khawatima Surah Al-Kahf, the final verses, the ending verses of Surah Al-Kahf, it will be a light for him on the day of judgment. And we have other traditions telling us about the merit of reciting Surah Al-Kahf on the night of Jummah or on the day of Jummah, and merits like, for example, would be among the shuhada, the martyrs, and will be raised as martyr if recite this continuously, this surah continuously on Jummah nights or days. Anyhow, The surah starts with hamd, alhamdu lillahi alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab. Praise to God, or thanks to God. I'll talk about the difference between the meanings. Who sent down the book to his abd, to his whatever abd mean. I have said several times, we don't have a good translation for abd in English. Servant, of course, is not abd. Slave is a closer meaning to abd. Someone who's a bondsman, somehow bound to other person, completely dependent on other person. So praise be to God who sent down the book to his dependent, to his bondsman. Now, there are five chapters in the Quran which starts with Alhamdulillah. The first is, of course, Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, which is an unqualified universal praise of God, Rabbil Alameen. All praise, all thanks goes to Allah, who is the Lord of the universe, of all the worlds. Then the other three surahs which start with hamd, it's about the creation. It's a qualified sort of praise. Praise for creation of everything. Surah An'am, Alhamdulillah alladhi khalaqa as-samawati wal-ard wa ja'ala adh-dhulumati wan-nur. So praise to God who created the heavens and the earth and made the darkness and light. So the praise is about him giving something out to others. I'll talk about this giving, which is actually the object of praise. Then in Surah Fatir, Alhamdulillah, Fatir as-samawati wal-arz, Ja'il al-mala'ikata rusulan, praise to God who brought the universe, the heavens and the earth, out of nothingness. This is Fatir as-samawati wal-arz. In Surah Saba, Alhamdulillah, alladhi lahu ma fi as-samawati wa ma fi al-arz. Again, it's about creation, about Allah owning all things in the universe. The only surah which talks about praises God for revelation of book is this chapter, of course, Surah Al-Kahf. Alhamdulillah, alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab. So here, it goes very well with the Sababun Nuzul, because Sababun Nuzul tells us that the revelation of kitab was stopped for certain period of time. And then it came. It came after 40 days or whatever lapse was there. And here, what was taken for granted by the Prophet and by all of us, that Allah should guide us. It's his duty to guide us. This is actually brought to our attention. You have to thank God for revealing this book to you. You have to thank God for giving you guidance. You take guidance for granted. Or sometimes, you see, we take this guidance to be a burden. That why Allah guides us to things which puts us in difficulty, and why we have to do certain things. Here, of course, it brings to our attention that you shouldn't take this for granted. This guidance is coming as a benevolence, as a mercy from Allah to you. So praise to God who sends you the book, who sent it to his abd, to his bondsman or dependent. Fakhruddin Razi has a very good observation here. He says, if you think deep, you would see the previous surah, Surah Isra. It starts with Subhanallah. Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa. So chapter 17 starts with Subhana, and chapter 18 starts with Alhamdulillah. Then he says, if we think deep, we will see that always Subhanallah goes before Alhamdulillah. And in Salat, we say, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. Fasabbih bihamd rabbik. do tasbih and hamd. Tasbih is to somehow purify, to put God above other things. This is tasbih, tanzih. And hamd is to praise. He says that tasbih should always come before tahmid. And that's why always in the book, in the Quran, and in our saying, we say tasbih before tahmid, before hamd. Because tasbih is actually to look at God in himself and purify him as something kamilan fi dhati, something who's perfect in his essence. And because he's perfect in his essence, it cannot be analyzed. It cannot be somehow divided into different concepts and then analyzed. Because if we want to analyze something, we have to divide it into smaller concepts and then analyze it. Because God cannot be divided into different concepts, smaller concepts. He could not be analyzed. He's above that. So when we think about God in himself, fi dhatih, we see that he is kamilun fi dhatih. He is perfect in his essence. So we always say subhanallah when we think about God in himself. When we think about God in relation to his creation, when he is mukammilan li ghayrih, he is giving perfection to other things. He's perfect in himself, subhanallah. He's giving perfection to other things. Of course, this brings praise, because this is what we understand from God. This is what we are told as well, that you cannot understand the essence of God because he's above our understanding, but you can understand his names. His names create the creation. Creation is manifestation of his names. So we always praise his names. We understand his names. Therefore, here, praise is usually given to something which is a giving away. God giving something away. God giving perfection to other things. So he says in Surah Al-Isra, when the Prophet is going to Mi'raj, to ascension, he's going to actually meet the Lord, we have to purify him from whatever comes into our imagination, like, for example, meeting the Lord, like one person meets another person. We are talking about God himself. It's ascension. When we want to go up towards the Lord, we have to have Subhanalladhi Asra Bi'Abdihi. But here, in Surah Kahf, when the revelation is coming down, and revelation is mukammilan li ghayrih, it is giving perfection. That guidance which comes from Allah gives perfection. So here we have to praise God. We have to say, Alhamdulillah, alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab, walam yaj'al lahu awaja. Now, what's the meaning of hamd? Hamd has two meanings, of course. One is praise, when you praise something for its own perfection. And sometimes it means thanks, when you thank something because it gives something to someone. We praise God, and that's a hamd, because he's perfect in himself. We thank God, and that's hamd as well, because, of course, he's giving perfection to other things. So when we say Alhamdulillah, especially Surah Al-Fatiha, when we say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, all praise and all thanks would go to Allah, Rabbul Alameen. Now here, hamd in Surah Al-Fatiha, hamd actually is somehow targeted towards both meanings. Because first we say Alhamdulillah, when we see Allah in himself, this is praise. We praise him. Then we say, when we say Rabbul Alameen, he is the one who gives perfection to the whole world. He is the one who is actually cherishing, sustaining the whole world. Then, of course, this is thanks. So here, hamd has both the meaning of thanks and praise. In this surah, we can take hamd to have either of the meanings, either praise to God, because he's kamil and fi dhati, or thanks to God because he sent down the book, and means to perfect other souls who live on the earth. You probably have heard of Qushayri, who's one of the famous scholars of the 5th century, and he has mystical sort of attitude as well. He has a very good observation here in this Alhamdulillah at the beginning of the surah. He says, if we take hamd to mean shukr, to mean thanks, that is because, of course, the book is one of the highest bounties and favors of God. It says, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihil kitab. Kitab is one of the highest favors of God, and therefore we thank him. And then abdihi here, his dependent, his bondsman, is mentioned as a specific sort of attention to the Prophet, that this came to this man, to this servant, which of course causes more thanks from the Prophet, peace be on him. If we take it as thana or as praise, then of course praise goes to God because he is the Lord. He is the one who has the authority to command and to forbid. And this is what he does in this book. And of course, abdihi here means this servant of mine, this abd, is the one who follows whatever I say in this book, and you have to follow him in this respect. This is one observation made by Qushayri here. So, Alhamdulillah, alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitab. The one, all praise or hamd is for Allah, who has revealed this book to his dependent, to his abd. And as Qushayri says here, this attribute given to the Prophet of being dependent and bondsman give a special sort of honor to the Prophet, that he is my servant. Servitude to God may be one-sided, maybe two-sided. Now, usually, of course, as a general rule, everyone is a bondsman of Allah. Everyone is dependent of God in a one-sided way, that from his side, of course, everything depends on him. Sometimes, if we believe in him and if we follow him, we voluntarily choose to be his dependent as well, meaning to confess, to acknowledge that we depend on you, that we are your abd. So everything in the universe is Abdullah. Shaitan is Abdullah. He's, of course, created by God, dependent on him. All the disbelievers are Ibadullah. In kullu man fis samawati wal ardi illa ati ar-rahmana abda. Everyone, everything which is in the heavens and in the earth, on the earth, they are actually ibad of Allah. They are servants of God, dependents on God. However, if we acknowledge it, like the angels acknowledge it, like the believers acknowledge that, then we become a sort of abd from this side as well. We decide to be his abd. Although we are always his abd from the other side, from this side, from our own side, we decide to be his abd as well. And here when he says abd, the attention is mostly on the side of the Prophet choosing to be his abd, to be his dependent, to acknowledging that he is his dependent. And this is, of course, a great sort of quality for the Prophet. Is an honor for the Prophet to be, and to acknowledge the bondsmanship of Allah. And of course, this is what we always say in Salat, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, abduhu wa rasuluh. He is abd, of course, abd in a mutual way. First of all, in reality is abd, in acknowledgement he's abd as well. He acknowledges to be Abdullah. Now, most of the people on this earth either do not acknowledge that they are Abdullah, or they partially acknowledge that they are Abdullah. If we fully acknowledge that we are Abdullah, then of course we will become like the saints and awliya Allah, that who fully acknowledge and leave everything to Allah, trust Him, because they acknowledge that He is their master, they acknowledge it. So this ala abdihi, this is a very pleasant sort of statement for the Prophet. All the time when Prophet hears this, that you are my abd, that meaning that, of course, shaitan is his abd as well, but here meaning that in acknowledgement, you are my abd as well. You are acknowledging this. This is a pleasant sort of praise for the Prophet, peace be on him, all the time hearing this from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, then two attributes, two qualities are mentioned for this book, which is sent down. First of all, لَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عَوَجًا. He did not put any crookedness for this book. And قَيِّمًا comes in the following verse. الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ الْكِتَابِ وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عَوَجًا قَيِّمًا. And these two qualities are mentioned to say that the purpose that this book should serve, لَيُنذَرَ بَعْسًا شَدِيدًا مِنْ لَدُنْهُ وَيُبَشِّرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, to warn a great chastisement on his side of Allah, and to give good news to believers. These two qualities make the book to serve the purpose perfectly. So what are these two qualities? First of all, لَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عَوَجًا. He did not put any crookedness in the book. And the second is, it is قَيِّم. It is straight. It is firm in its purpose. Now, awaj, in other places of the Quran as well, is mentioned. For example, in Surah Zumar, we have Quranan Arabiyan غَيْرَ ذِي awajin لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. This is a Quran without any crook in it. Crookedness, when we talk about objects, of course, in object is awaj, in concept is awaj. In objects, when we talk about, for example, a wood or an arrow having awaj, it means it's bent somewhere, it's crooked, it is somehow not completely straight. And especially for an arrow, if it has some crookedness, it's difficult to hit the target for the arrow. Now, for the concepts, when concepts are not straightforward, are not understandable, when concepts are not absolutely right, when they are void, and all these meanings, if one of them is attached to a concept, that concept become the awaj, having some crook in it. Even in our ordinary conversation, of course, when we talk to each other, sometimes our statements are quite straightforward, are very understandable. Sometimes it's very difficult to understand, or there are lots of doubts in it, and this is the crook or crookedness which is in the statement. Now, in the Quran, there is no crook. There is no crookedness. It should be understood in a very plain and straightforward way. There is no bent in its concepts, something which probably brings some bottle, some void things into it. There is nothing like that. The book is absolutely and perfectly haq, and everything in this is correct. And for this reason, it could be qayyim. Qayyim, we know, of course, about people who become guardian of others. We say they are qayyim. For example, this man is qayyim of this child. Looking after the masalih, looking after the benefits of someone, looking after the affairs of someone, makes a person to be qayyim of other person. When we talk about the book being qayyim, it means this book looks after your masalih. This book can put you on the right course. This is qayyim. Again, Fakhr Razi, on that concept that he brings in, that kamilan fi dhatih mukammilan li ghayrih, he said about God, is kamilan fi zati, is perfect in its essence, then he's mukammilan lighir, he gives perfection. He says the book also should be like that. If it wants to give benefits, if it wants to give perfection to others, it should be perfect in itself as well. It should be kamilan fi zati and then mukammilan lighirih. So here it's mentioned like that. Lam yaj'al lahu awaja, is kamilan fi zati, is perfect in itself, the book. There is nothing which would blemish this book in terms of wrongness. And then it is mukammilan lighayri. It can be qayyaman. It can be guardian of you in terms of guidance. It can guide you. And then he says, this is exactly what we have in Surah Baqarah. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ means غَيْرَ ذِي awaj. There is no awaj in it. There's no doubt in it. There is no crook in it. And then because of that, it could be guidance for others. Hudan lil muttaqin. And here, qayyaman has the same meaning. It is hudan, of course, lil muttaqin. It's qayyim as well. So the two qualities which are mentioned here, qayra zi awajin, lam yaj'al lahu awaja, and also qayyaman, are actually mentioned in other verses of the Quran in a different way, of course. Other meanings are given to qayyim, like for example, it is qayyim over the guidance of God, not over people, meaning that it is actually a benchmark for other books revealed before the Quran, like Torah and Injil. وَأَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ كتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه ومهيمنا عليه من الكتاب ومهيمنا عليه. So it is a benchmark, it's a sort of watch over other books of God. If anything in other books is deviating from this guidance, of course it's wrong. This is the benchmark for the guidance of God. This is another meaning given to qayyiman. And there are other things, of course, mentioned here, which would prolong the discussion about why, for example, qayyiman has come after lam yaj'al lahu awaja. It should have been like this. Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba qayyiman wa lam yaj'al lahu awaja. Qayyiman should be an attribute of a description of kitab initially, but there is a sort of taqdim and ta'khir. Something has come first and which should have been second, and the order of the sentence is changed. Fakhr Razi says, no, this is wrong, because lam yaj'al lahu awaja is kamilan fi zati, is perfect in itself, it should come first. Qayyiman, which is mukammilan li ghayri, giving perfection to others, should come second. These are, of course, the periphery, somehow marginal issues discussed in this verse. Okay, this book, of course, is revealed. Praise to God, thanks to God. It is qayyiman, it doesn't contain any awaj, any crook. To do what? لِيُنذِرَ بَأْسًا شَدِيدًا مِنْ لَدُنْهُ. To warn a painful, a grave chastisement on the side of God. وَيُبَشِّرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And to give good news to the believers. الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ. Those who do good. The good news is that أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا حَسَنًا. Now, there are several things here that we have to discuss. First of all, why there is a great chastisement on the side of God, with God. Why with God there is a great chastisement? And why it has come first? Because we know that the purpose of the creation is, of course, those who prosper and go to paradise, not those who actually fall and go to hell. This is a side effect of the creation. So the purpose is that why initially ba'asan shadidan? Why this ba'as, this chastisement is grave? Why? The second question. The third question is, what is the meaning of salihat? Because of course the believers are mentioned, yubashir al-mu'minin, but there is, of course, a qualification for that. Not every mu'min, but alladhina ya'maluna salah, those who do good things. And thirdly, ajran hasana. What is al-ajr al-hasan? Of course, ajr we know, reward. Of course, there's reward for them. Good reward. What's the good reward, which is mentioned in this verse? Inshallah, we'll discuss these in our next session. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi at-tahirin.
Thank you very much indeed, Sheikh. Started the question and answer. I pass one mic to the ladies. Just to keep it with you, I'll pass one mic to the other side and whoever wants to start. Yes, it's already on.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. Welcome back. You haven't lost any of your touch while you've been away. The first thing is, when it said the book, was it already a given that he had come with the book, even though this is an early Meccan surah? Because he, when you said the 40 days, it was right at the beginning of the Elan of Nabuwah. So when it says this is a book, it wasn't a complete book at the time. So was it a given that this, I am a Rasul, I have come with a book which hasn't been revealed yet?
Yeah. Well, the surah is revealed between year 8 or and 12. It's not known exactly what time it was revealed. So it was quite a while after the book was revealed. Several chapters had been revealed before. In the order which is mentioned by historians of the Quran, they say this is the 69th surah. So before the 68 surahs were revealed. However, the concept of book, of course, has a concrete sort of, is a concrete concept of a book which is complete, but gradually is revealed to the prophets. So, for example, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, tilka ayatul kitab al-mubin. These are the ayat of the book. So the book is there. It should be revealed to the Prophet completely by the end of his mission, but it is coming gradually. So anzala ala abd al-kitab means that book is being revealed to the Prophet.
Thank you. Any sisters? Any brother? Yeah.
Just a very quick one, really. You see, the sequence of Subhanallah being before Alhamdulillah that you explained, and Tasbih Fatima Zahra is the other way around, but at the same time, the Ahl Sunnah say the Tasbih with Subhanallah before Alhamdulillah, I think.
Yeah, we have such traditions as well. In our traditions, there is also this difference in the order, but this order is chosen by most of the scholars. Of course, it doesn't mean that we always, when we, for example, want to say the zikr of Subhanallah, we say it before Alhamdulillah, but when we say them together, because these are separate, we say 33 times Alhamdulillah, 33 times Subhanallah, when we say it together, always in the Quran as well, the same thing. Tasbih comes before Hamd. Yeah.
Any sisters? Sheikh, we know that the Prophet for about 40 days or so did not receive revelation. Do we know exactly what he was, or what was he going through, and how was he remembering Allah, and the specifics? What was sort of overcoming?
No, we don't know, but certainly he wouldn't have said, "Guy, why me among other prophets?" Because these are people who always praise God in any situation. And certainly he should have known that this is for a reason. This interruption in revelation should be for a reason. And that's why when he met Jibreel, he didn't actually say a very strong sort of word. What is this? I have been disgraced among my people. Or he said, "Abta'ta ya Jibreel." You have been slow bringing the revelation. A sort of soft reminder that what has happened. He wanted to know what happened. And of course, the Quran explains, وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا. Never say, I do something tomorrow. إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ. We don't know what happened. There are certain traditions talking about, for example, him being somehow grieved, sad. Even some say he wanted to somehow get away from people. But these are not authentic at all. We don't really know what happened.
Yes, you see, why I'm asking is, when we are going through some difficulties, we pray, we try to remember Allah more, and do more tasbih. So was he doing like this, or how was it?
There's nothing that Prophet could do more than what he usually did.
Okay, brother, somebody here?
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Carrying on from that theme of the 40 days where he didn't receive revelation, I wanted to ask, did anyone make the accusation? Obviously, this leaves the Prophet vulnerable to accusations that he found out the answers or the stories the same way that the people that asked him the questions. And do we have any records that anyone made this accusation?
No, because apparently the Prophet did not know those people in Najran, and it was not possible. He was in Mecca, of course. He could not travel to Najran and find out about this. So never this accusation was brought up, no.
Okay, we'll go to the sisters first and then come to the brothers here.
Alaikum salam.
There is a switch there, can you? No. Remove the mute. There shouldn't be a live mute.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh. Alaikum salam. The Prophet had the whole of the Quran revealed to him in his heart at the time of revelation. So what's the difference between that revelation and the gradual revelation?
Yeah, what was revealed to the heart of the Prophet was the whole idea of the guidance. It was, as they say, it was mujmal. It was somehow not quite elaborate in its meanings. He didn't know about the elaborate stories which were coming into this book. For example, after mentioning the story of Nuh in Surah Hud, Allah says, تلك من أنباء الغيب نوحيها إليك ما كنت تعلمها أنت ولا قومك من قبل هذا. These are the unseen news we are revealing to you. Neither you nor your people knew about this before revelation of these verses. So the gradual revelation gave the elaboration of what the Prophet knew in himself as a wisdom. And, you know, when we have wisdom, when we face with every situation, that wisdom works and gives us the right direction. However, we don't know about the elaborate instances that we are going to use this wisdom. The wisdom is there. It's just like that. The book came down to the heart of the Prophet. Of course, some people deny that. Even some Shia exists deny that this has been the case. But for those who believe that this happened, it was like a wisdom which should find its elaboration in different instances, like that, something like that.
Thanks. Any sisters before we come to the brothers? Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum.
Thank you. We've been missing you so much for so many months.
Thank you.
Now, the meaning of Qayyiman, you said it's like a benchmark of the other books. But when you study the Bible and the Torah, there is a few differences which is there. So how would we sort of justify that?
Benchmark exactly means that. That if there is something opposing this book, differences, of course, may not be in opposition, but if there's something in those books which opposes this, it means we take this as a benchmark and discard them. We say they are wrong. When this book is Muhaiman, is a watch over other books, it means that whatever conforms with this book in those other books is right, probably is revelation. And we know there are many things in the Bible, both New Testament and Old Testament, which conform with the Quran. And we don't say that they are completely wrong. And this is why we regard Jews and Christians as people of the book. We actually acknowledge their book. However, benchmark means that, okay, for you Muslims, if you find anything in opposition to this book, then you have to know that this is an addition. This is a deviation. This is the role of the benchmark.
Thank you. Brothers, Manjuri, anything?
Alaykum salam.
Sorry. I just wondered if you could elaborate again on this, when you're talking about the book being straight and there's no crookedness. And so is that something to do with the meaning in terms of the Quran? You know, you're saying that it should be understood. So, because we always look at it in terms of there are other meanings rather than the apparent meaning and things like that. So how does that actually work with that?
No. There are depths of meanings. You see, there is no other meaning for what we understand, of course. There is depth of meaning. When we say it's quite a straight understandable, it doesn't mean that anyone can refer to this book and understand. Of course, it needs some expertise. For example, if you have a book on chemistry, and you say, this is a very clear book, it explains everything about chemistry, it doesn't mean that I can go and read it and understand everything. An expert should go, someone who has the knowledge should go and read it and understand it. Now, if I read it, I of course understand certain things. It doesn't mean that we are absolutely stupid with regards to that, but the depth of that meaning is only understood by an expert. The Quran is the same thing, of course. If I go and read it based on my knowledge, I understand certain things from it, but if a mufassir goes and reads it, of course there's more depth to that meaning. Now, if a man with a spiritual knowledge reads it, there's more depth in it. If it's revealed to the prophet who has the ultimate wisdom, of course he understands different things. So these are depths of meaning, not that they oppose each other, or the ta'wil never should oppose the tanzil. This is what we believe in. Yeah.
Thank you. Manjuri.
You mentioned the qualification of an abd, that abd, one is from the side of Allah, that everybody is abd. And the second one is that when the person acknowledges that he is abd, that is the second part of it. This acknowledgement and the quality of tawakkal, is it how can we increase this this quality of tawakkal by acknowledging this being abd? If you can explain this.
Yeah, of course, the more we acknowledge that we depend on him, then the more we rely on him. Of course, that depends on the faith and the depth of the faith, the degree of the faith. The more our faith increases, then the more we acknowledge our bondsmanship, dependence on Allah, and that brings more reliance. And then more reliance brings more acknowledgement of dependence. It's just like a sort of dialectical process. What you do affects your next step, the next step affects the previous step. Therefore, we have to increase the faith. And increasing the faith, we are told, is possible by continuously doing salihat, good deeds. And good deeds include worship, include charity, include discipline in our own self. These are the three relations: relation with God, relation with people, relation with our souls. And then, of course, our attitude towards this world. The more we ponder and see the world as a transient sort of thing, the more we rely on God. The more we think this as a solid, permanent thing, the more we rely on this world. So the four connections, which is mentioned in Misbah al-Sharia, that's the principle of the interactions are four, between you and God, between you and yourself, between you and people, and between you and this world. These actually would, if we discipline this, it increases our faith. And when our faith increases, our acknowledgement that we are Abdullah would increase.
Thank you. Sisters? Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum. Alaykum as-salam. Just wanted to ask, what do you mean by that there's no contradiction between the ta'wil and the tanzil? What do you mean by the tanzil, the revelation of the book itself, or the actions of the Prophet, or maybe the early interpretations of
Tanzil usually is the apparent meanings of the verses. This is what is meant by tanzil. And ta'wil is the deeper meanings of the verses. And there shouldn't be any contradiction between them. So when we give it, or when the imam, for example, gives a ta'wil to a verse, it is either an instance of that tanzil, or it's a deeper concept which is brought to our attention of that tanzil. It cannot oppose the tanzil, because then the book opposes itself.
Any other sister before we come to brothers?
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
It's reasonably easy to say Alhamdulillah, because when you look at the world around you, you can marvel at the creation. But how can you help me understand how to say Subhanallah?
Yeah, this is very difficult, Subhanallah. Because Subhanallah is acknowledgement of our lack of knowledge. Isn't it? When we say Subhanallah, we acknowledge that we cannot know God, that He's beyond our comprehension. I think the best way of somehow internalizing this is to acknowledge that God, we cannot know Him. This is the best thing. Hamd is, of course, is deepened by knowing things. The more you know about the nature, the more you know about yourself, the more you know about creation, the hamd deepens in you. But Subhanallah means that the less you know about God is the better. Acknowledging, as the Prophet said, Subhanaka ma arafnaka haqqa ma'arifatik. We never knew you the way you deserve to be known. And of course, that is very difficult for us. That's why usually we say Subhanallah without knowing what we are saying.
Thank you. Any brothers? Anybody? Any sisters? Okay. Shukran, Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.